Okay, boys, let us now talk about our all-time flyweight top 10. Before we get into our top 10s, does anybody have any honorable mentions that they would like to throw out there?
I just want to point out this, this list.
Fucking right in.
This weight class was particularly difficult, and I had a really hard time. And the longer that I had to look at this list, the longer I had to keep fucking with it. The easiest, I even think the easiest was probably the top four or five. And even then, trying to figure out what Jenga pieces to put them in was also a pain in my ass. But it got weirder from six all the way down. And I totally a lot agree. Of guys that I started with on my list ended up being in my honorable mentions by the end of it as I tried to reason things. But here we go.
We had really similar experiences. That was like the exact description of my feelings as well.
My honorable mentions are Tim Elliott, Sergio Pettis, and Kyoji Horiguchi. Those are my three ones there, mainly because while they had a slight impact at flyweight, they have also spent a significant amount of time and significant more success at bantamweight. So it's hard to really stuff them into the top 10 of the actual flyweight division. So that was my big thing there.
Mark?
All right. I'll say just super briefly, there's a lot of like modern day guys, because I feel like this division's not that old. Roy Valen, Cara France, and Askarov, and Manel Kopp. Like, there's a lot of guys like that who in another couple years could be relevant on this list, but they're not there yet, so I couldn't consider guys like that. I have a few more honorables than Omar did. I'll do one as kind of like a trio, which is the old school trio of Shinichi Kojima, Yasuhiro Yurushitani, and Mamoru Yamaguchi. They are all like three legends in Japanese MMA. They were kind of like the first flyweight studs in a way. Yurushitani actually does have a win over a very early in his career, John Dodson. He split a series with Yamaguchi. Kojima beat Yamaguchi. They were all great. I'm sure you'll find lists where at least one of them, if not more, is in the top 10. I just couldn't pull that trigger. I feel like you do have to factor in the quality of competition at least a little bit. They all do have plenty of losses to some random guys mixed in there, so I couldn't justify jumping them into my top 10 or even putting them over my other two honorable mentions. So that is them as a trio. My next guy, who I guess would be number 12, is Adrian Omerice. It does feel a bit weird to me to not have a guy who knocked out Demetrius Johnson in the top 10. Not to mention he's the only guy to ever finish DJ, bantamweights included. So it's one hell of a feather in his cap, and it's why he's, I guess, in my honorables. But aside from that, I just felt like his resume is not incredibly deep. It's a very similar situation to why Holly Holm was not in my top 10, despite having the knockout of Ronda. And not to mention, yes, he's a flyweight in one, but if he ever had to actually make 125, I'm not sure he could. So
I don't think he could ever make 125.
Yeah, I feel okay leaving him out. And then my last honorable mention is a wild one to me, in that I never expected to leave him out of my top 10 until I started digging into guys' resumes. Especially considering he's the first person I ever really remember viewing as like the quote-unquote king of the flyweights. And that man is Uncle Creepy, Ian McCall. Back when he was in Tachi Palace fights, beating Jussie Formiga, he was the man. He was the top flyweight in the world. But not a lot happened after that, if we're being honest. And Formiga went on to build a resume that certainly surpassed McCall's, in my opinion. Of course, McCall did have that infamous draw with Demetrius Johnson in the UFC, but he then lost the rematch. He lost to Benavidez, lost to Lineker, lost to Kopp, lost to Horiguchi. There wasn't much else on that resume. And it's not like he was old when he was losing all those fights. He was 27 when he lost to DJ, and he was 33 by the time he was done. So that should have been his prime. So to me, there was just not enough depth on his resume, despite the fact that he was once the top man. So he just missed my top 10.
Okay. I'll throw a couple names out there for my honorables. I also have Moraes in my honorables, and I'll throw in Ian McCall in my honorables. At one time was a very hot fighter, very popular guy. Derailed, utterly derailed by fight cancellations. I pulled up a stat that...
That boy was plagued by injuries, man. Ian McCall's body was not okay.
Yes.
He'd been booked for 6 consecutive fights that were canceled, 4 of which were canceled during the week of the fight. I mean, come on.
Wow, that's crazy.
Yeah, I didn't know it was that bad. But yeah, I remember him consistently being plagued with injuries, especially his hands. His hands were constantly fucked up almost all the time.
Who would like to go first? 10 through... Mark, why don't you lead us off?
Me, huh?
Lead us off with the energy.
All right. Let's do it. Number 10. The magician, John Dotson. In a way, it feels like Dotson is like a little bit of a journeyman. Or at least that's how he feels to me. I don't know if that's how he feels to you guys. And I personally never expected to be putting him in this top 10 when I started doing this list. Like, I would have said McCall over him if you had asked me before I really looked at it. But when you stop and think about it, pretty much all of the John Dotson up and downs happened at bantamweight. All of his UFC losses, other than the 2 title fights against DJ, were at bantamweight. And at flyweight, it's just those 2. And then it's wins over Tim Elliott, over Zach Makovsky, a KO of Montague, a TKO of Moraga, a TKO of Formiga, which is Ian McCall's best win, and Dotson did it even better than him. So, and then there's even bantamweight wins, too, over guys like Wineland and Munoz and a young TJ Dillashaw, of course. So I could see people not loving the Dotson inclusion, and feel free to let me know in the comments if you're listening and you want to argue it, but I had a hard time leaving him out of my 10. Not to mention he's never been finished, not one time in his life, at any weight, and is still knocking out dudes in Rizin as we speak. So he is my number 10 fighter. Moving right along, number 9, Alexandre Pantoja. This was my modern-day resume not quite complete yet type of inclusion, but it's with good reason. I mean, let's start with the fact that he's 2-0 against Brandon Moreno, who is obviously going to be a lot higher up on this list. Yes, one of them was on tough, but to both of those men, I'm sure they feel their record is 2-0 and 0-2. And he's currently on his best run of all. He beat Manel Kopp. He tapped Brandon Royval. He tapped Alex Perez. Yes, he's gotten beat by Figgy and by Askarov and even Dustin Ortiz early in his career. But the dude has 25 wins. He's 25-5. He's another one who's never once been finished. And you factor in the quality of the losses and the depth of the resume, along with 2 wins over Moreno, which he'll try to make 3 very soon. And I'm comfortable having him in the top 10 here. So he comes in at 9 for me. Number 8, a man that Omar left off, Kyoji Horiguchi. I love Kyoji, man. I always have. I always will. He is a guy, as Omar mentioned, who has spent a lot of his career fighting at 135, despite being continually undersized there since he's a natural flyweight. And he's still beaten top bantamweights like Kai Asakura. He has a 1-1 series with him. Darian Caldwell twice back when he was the Bellator champ. I mean, he's got a record of 31-5, and only one of those losses is at flyweight, which is his true weight class, and it's to Demetrius Johnson. So one flyweight loss, and it's to DJ. He did also lose to Sergio Pettis at bantamweight, who you could kind of look at as a fellow flyweight, but even still then call it 2 losses. And at flyweight, he's beaten Oigi Kubo 3 times. He KO'd Ian McCall. He subbed Manel Kopp. He beat Ali Bagoutinov, who's another guy with a solid flyweight resume. And he was 7-1 as a flyweight in the UFC. So, again, you can nitpick as to why a lot of these guys do or not belong. As Omar mentioned, it was kind of tough to stack these guys out. But for me, the fact that he never loses at his actual weight class of flyweight was enough for me to put him on this list. So he comes in at 8 for me. Number 7, definitely my most surprising one to myself, Sergio Pettis. The current Bellator bantamweight champion. Never would have thought I'd have him this high until I looked at it. I know some people might hate it. Another one, let me know in the comments. But I feel like it's pretty easy to forget this man's resume. Like, he did get knocked out by Ryan Benoit. So let's get that one out of the way. Not a good loss. But that aside, his only other flyweight losses are Henry Cejudo and Jussie Formiga. He beat John Moraga. He beat Brandon Moreno. He beat Joseph Benavidez. And granted, it was up a weight class, but he KO'd the man I just talked about in Kyoji Horiguchi. So all in all, he's got one bad loss at flyweight and wins over Moreno, Formiga, Benavidez, Horiguchi. That's a pretty damn good resume that I feel like is easy to forget about for Sergio Pettis. So it's another guy I like I said, I hadn't really thought of being on this list, but once I dug in, I was like, well, I guess he's on here. So he comes in at 7 for me. And then to round out this first half of the top 10, my number 6 is Jussie Formiga. We finally hit the other half of the original flyweight kings, at least my original flyweight kings, in terms of him and McCall. He was the man in the late 2000s. He beat Kojima, who I talked about in my honorables. He beat a young Pantoja. He did lose to McCall, but then after that, he put together one hell of a UFC career. He did get beat. You know, Dotson finished him. Benavidez finished him twice. He lost to Cejudo and Moreno. But the resume of wins is large. I mean, Kojima, Pantoja, Yamaguchi, Cariasso, Makovsky, Ortiz, Pettis, Figueiredo. Like, I just named 5 guys in my top 15 that Formiga has beaten. So I get it, he has some losses in there, but that's more than I can say for anyone I've said on this list thus far, and I think he should rightfully be this high on the list. So that is my number 6, and I will now pass the baton to whoever wants it.
So you had Formiga at 6, Sergio at 7.
Kyoji at 8. Pantoja at 9. Dotson at 10.
Pantoja at 9?
Yep.
Okay, Dotson. Omar. Do you think?
So my number 10 is Ian McCall.
I figured and you must have him on there.
Yeah, you know, I'll be honest, I think some of it has to do with my personal love for Ian McCall. And I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that that was how I personally was introduced to the flyweight division. You know, apart from Demetrius Johnson, if I look back to my earliest memories of the flyweight division, Ian McCall for me was one of those staples, very much like the Joseph Benavidez's and things like that. And he had a lot of potential, but, you know, life really fucked that dude. You know, besides the fact that he had one of those, you know, he had an addiction to certain substances and things like that. He ended up getting over or working through. I don't know how that, you know, I'm sure that's not one of those things you get over necessarily. But one of the things he had to work through, and again, he had a ton of injuries consistently throughout his career, especially after the Demetrius fight more so than anything. So I feel like he was one of those guys that had a lot of potential in the flyweight division, was definitely a recognizable name, fought a ton of guys, but just even with all of those pullouts, he still fought a good amount of people in there, but he just never, his body was never able to keep up with what I think he was able to do in his mind, which will always make me sad for him. But that was my number 10. Brandon Royval was actually one of the newer house names that I had at number 9. I think apart from his resume, as Mark has already talked about, Royval is one of those guys that for me, his performances, I think also say a large part about him as a fighter and where he deserves to be. I think he's one of those guys that is a very good and well-rounded fighter. I think he'll be around at the top of the division for quite some time. I don't know what his ceiling is with his recklessness kind of being a big thing. He's not necessarily always better than the guys that he's beating necessarily, but he's always finding a way to beat guys that are better than him. And I think that his record right now is pretty strong. And like Mark was saying, the flyweight division is still, it's still so young, and I can't look too far back at a lot of these earlier flyweights, especially from the Japanese era, because the level of competition just isn't, it's just so far apart, right? Like I would never put Don Fry really in a greatest of all time, right? As much of a legend as he is, I would never put him in a greatest of all time because I just don't think he's technically that great of a fighter. He was just in an era where his skill set was dominant, because no one else had anything to really work with, right? So that's kind of how I feel about the earlier, the sort of the golden age, if you will, of the flyweight division. But I think Roy Val deserves to be in the number nine spot. I think he's kind of worked his way to a point where I'm comfortable putting him there. And I had to think about the Kai Kara Francis and all this other stuff too, like Mark also mentioned, but I felt comfortable putting Roy Val there. I didn't feel comfortable putting Kai Kara Francis there. Number eight, I have Jussier Formiga. I won't run through a lot of the same things that Mark said, but Formiga's resume is extremely strong. This is one of those Jenga pieces I had a really difficult time figuring out where it really fit, what made the most sense. And a couple of these, all in all, I just tried to put them in a certain order and see how I felt about one being on top of the other. And if I felt comfortable enough with it, I just left it there. So I put Jussier Formiga right at number eight. I did put John Dodson right over him at number seven. Dodson is, again, another one of these guys that to me is synonymous with the flyweight division. And that is totally understanding that he's fought at 135 a lot more than I think he should have been. He recently returned to flyweight and recently took a body home with him. I think 125 is a great division for him. I think he was at a time where, and Demetrius Johnson talks about it all the time, how Dodson was arguably the toughest fight that he's ever had. And Dodson is probably one of the fastest human beings you'll see fighting, like, ever. And it's very difficult to not give him the respect that he deserves and what he's done in the early stages of the UFC flyweight division. And even now, out of the UFC's stage, still now going back to flyweight and still representing for that division. So I put Dodson at number seven. Number six is who I will always call the prince of the 125-pound division, Joseph Benavidez. Always the bridesmaids, never the bride. That man will always go down in my heart as the guy who was always at the tippy top of the division, but could just never grab onto that gold. And it kind of sucks, but he's a legend, man. He's a legend. He's had some great fights, some great finishes. I still think about the finish where he had the dude in a mounted guillotine with homeboy's legs and arms wrapped up, where this man was kicking to try to tap out because he had no other appendage to use to do so. One of the greatest things I've ever seen. I thought it was a fantastic performance. And it's things like that that make me remember Benavidez and his resume against guys who at the championship and elite levels and at the top of the division for like the longest time cannot be ignored. So Joseph Benavidez at number six.
Okay. I start out my top 10 with Mr. John the Magician Dodson. First off, one of the best personality and nickname matches we've ever seen. That being said, at flyweight, 125 pounds, and in the lighter weight classes in general, John Dodson, a tremendous talent, maybe a little bit before his time. His stint at flyweight in the UFC was tremendous. He had that early win over TJ Dillashaw and came quite close to defeating Demetrius Mighty Mouse Johnson. As you guys have alluded to, he's one of the toughest opponents that Johnson has faced.
He was up 2-0, if I remember right. And DJ had to come back and win them all.
Yeah.
Not to interject.
So, no, please do. So while his record does include losses to the likes of Johnson, you know, his performances definitely have solidified his status as one of the top 125ers all time, in my opinion. I think he belongs within the top 10, even though he hasn't stacked up the accolades like some others have. For number nine, I have Jussier Formiga. Formiga, unfortunately, is one of these guys who holds this distinction of one of the greatest fighters ever to not compete for a title, let alone win one. So despite never even challenging for the belt, he has had a very impressive career, one of the truly great submission threats, in his record standing at 24-8, 11 subs. He has never been subbed in his whole career. He does have losses over guys like Joe B, but he does have some great career wins over guys like Davis and Figueiredo, Sergio Pettis. So that's why I have him at number nine. Number eight, I have a guy who is still active and doing big things at the very top of the flyweight division. That is Alexandre Pantoja. Pantoja at my eighth spot. In just about a five-year span in the UFC, he has left already a significant mark. He's one of the few guys who have beaten Brandon Moreno and still active and still wanting that fight. He's 25-5 right now with a 70% finish rate. And he is certainly, I think he's one of the best 125ers in the world right now. So he has victories, like I said, over Moreno, over Kopp, Kaikar, France. So that's why I have him at number eight. My number seven is Kyoji Horiguchi. Definitely has made his mark in the UFC, but he also has continued to showcase his talents as he has left the UFC and beyond. Went on to win championships with Ryzen and Bellator, defeating notable opponents like Ian McCall, Benel Kopp, Darian Caldwell. All right, and he also is the owner of an outstanding 13-fight win streak. So that's why I got Horiguchi sliding in at the seventh spot. And finishing my top 10 through 6, how do you say that? I have Sergio Pettis.
Wow, I thought I was high at 7. There you go.
Sergio Pettis initially faced some challenges in the UFC, but eventually found his stride, has defeated prominent flyweights like Brandon Moreno and Joseph Benavidez, and has established himself as one of the best at 125 pounds in the world. He now is obviously in Bellator, where he continues to thrive and has held Bellator gold. I had to put him over Horiguchi because he knocked him out. Yeah. So that's Mike, rounding out my...
Say we again? Have the same exact five men, just in a different order.
Funny. I will continue on if you guys would like me to.
Oh,
we can do sort of a round robin, and we'll do Omar, right, and then we'll end with Mark.
All right.
Coming in at number five for me is Joseph Benavidez. Like other fighters on this list, faced the dominant. Unfortunately, he was in the Demetrius Mighty Mouse Johnson era. It was his era. I think of John Jones being like, this is my era. Sorry, this is my era. That's what it was with DJ, man. And unfortunately, Joe B ran into that juggernaut. Despite his losses to Mighty Mouse, Benavidez has had an exceptional record and secured victories over other renowned names like Henry Cejudo, Juicio Formiga, and Ian McCall. So he has definitely left quite the legacy of flyweight. Number four, here we go. I have at number four, Davison Figueiredo. Figueiredo, the first ever two-time UFC flyweight champion, initially flew under the radar, but now he proves proved his worth by capturing the gold more than once. He absolutely dominated guys like Joseph Benavidez in one-sided rivalries and continued his success with victories over Alex Perez and has beaten Brandon Moreno. Unfortunately, I couldn't have him higher than four, as we will see, because of his rivalry with that man. But Figueiredo has been arguably, more than anybody on this list, I would say the biggest juggernaut at 125 pounds. A man at this lightweight class who I cringe to think about. What, you know, he's like the boogeyman of the division, man. Other guys like Moreno, Cejudo, Johnson, Pettis, all these guys, Horiguchi, hard hitters, Pantoja, hard hitter. Nobody's like Figueiredo, man, at 125 pounds. That being said, for me, number three is Brandon Moreno. Brandon Moreno's storyline is that of an underdog who rose to the top. After being released by the UFC, he returned and went on quite an impressive run, ending with winning the flyweight title, going back and forth with Figueiredo, as we now know. And his accomplishments, the resilience that he's shown, has been nothing short of inspiring. And he's one of the few men ever to hold the belt. And probably one of the most inspiring champions that I've seen in quite some time. My number two is Mr. Henry Cejudo. obviously, he's Triple C. And while I, earlier in this list, I pointed out My number 10, I started out my list, with John Dodson being the best personality and nickname match. And towards the top of the list, I think Henry Cejudo is one of the worst personality and nickname matches that we've seen, with his nickname being The Messenger. Every time I see that his nickname is The Messenger, I'm like, oh yeah, I forgot that his nickname, he has this weird nickname, The Messenger. Maybe there's some story behind it. I don't know. Obviously, I mean, when we talk about accolades, guys further down the list like the Formigas, the Dodsons, who lack those accolades, this is a guy who certainly has them. He's the Triple C. He has the multiple UFC titles going along with the Olympic gold, and that's why I have him so high at my number two. And, of course, number one, spoilers, at the cat's out of the bag, guys. My number one is Demetrius Mighty Mouse Johnson. Just incredible. He's one of the greatest of all time, let alone the greatest flyweight ever. Such an incredible run between 2012 and 2018 that established himself as one of the greats of all time, with a record of 12-0-1 during that period. He won the flyweight title, and he holds the record for most consecutive title defenses with 11. He defeated just about everybody. Several former and future champions would be future champions, and solidified his place among the absolute legends of the sport. Many people have him on their Mount Rushmores, etc., etc. DJ's the man. Okay, Omar, your top five.
I'm dying to know who Omar has at five over Joseph Benavidez. It's blowing my mind who this person could be.
Do you guys want to know the random thought I just had?
Sure. Yes.
Do you remember when they tried to sell us that Patrick Cummins might beat DC?
Yes. They had to promote
what
it. They
a fucking
had to
wild
it.
Time that was, wasn't it? Fuck.
That was a random thought for sure.
Oh, it was super random. It's so, I guess, to put some context to it, you were talking about Triple C. That led me to Olympics, that led me to Patrick Cummins at DC, and how ridiculous of a fucking selling point that really ended up being towards the end, because Patrick Cummins was awful. God.
He was, awful. Okay. Give
he had a solid little career, dude.
Give the guy some respect. The guy fucking worked at Starbucks.
Yeah,
and
he beat some guys in the UFC.
The guy had wrestling, but he was terrible, man. I hated watching him fight. I thought he was.
I mean, he beat Jan Blachowicz. Like, his career was
he
not terrible.
He wrestled Jan Blachowicz.
I mean, but he. How many people beat Jan Blachowicz?
I guess, but once Jan Blachowicz learns how to stop a takedown, Patrick Cummins all of a sudden doesn't know what to do. He was horrible. Yeah. I wasn't a fan.
Okay.
Anyway.
Back on track.
Enough shitting on this poor guy. It's just a random thought. All right. So my top five. Number five, Alexandre Pantoja. Pantoja has a solid resume, man. And his performances himself, it's difficult for me as somebody who likes to watch these guys and almost study them to a certain extent and take away, you know, their fighting styles and their approaches and things like that. Pantoja not only has a solid resume, but man, the way he fights has to be taken into consideration. His performances, I think, are really, really top notch. He is a very aggressive fighter, but he's very technical and gets the job done, man. I'm a big fan of him and the way he fights and the performances he puts on. So I had him at number five. And basically fighters one through four are exactly the same as what Mike had. I have Davison Figueiredo at number four. Couldn't put him any higher because Brandon Moreno is 2-0 or 2-1 against him. I have Brandon Moreno at number three. Brandon Moreno, I think at this point, has proven that hard work has gotten him to this point. He was able to grind his way to multiple UFC belts at this point, obviously dropping his first defense, if I'm not mistaken, against Davison Figueiredo, and then picking him back up. I'm a big fan, man. Obviously, you guys know I tend to gush on Moreno quite a bit. I'm a huge fan of that nerd. And yeah,
I was very curious if you would have him at number two. I really was.
I wanted to. The reality is had we had a fight, obviously, between Cejudo and Moreno, it would be a lot clearer. But
for sure, yeah.
As much as I love Moreno, he's not an Olympic champion. And he's not an Olympic champion that has shown that he's also effective with that skill set in the octagon. And Henry Cejudo, I think, is, you know, for all the shit he took against Aljo and all this other stuff, Aljo is a gigantic human being. Like, you got to cut this man a break a little bit. Aljo is massive. And the fact that he got takedowns at all against Aljo, in my opinion, is absolutely savage. So I think there's a lot of things that people need to take into consideration with that fight at 135. But at 125, I think that Henry Cejudo is one of the best fighters. And I would put him in number one if it wasn't for the fact that I think that Demetrius Johnson is just the best fighter in the world. Technique for technique. God, I understand there's John Jones and he's got the resume to back it, and he's definitely got technique to back up the argument as well. But like, if I look at their fighting styles and I just compare them, if I just compare the fighting styles, I prefer Demetrius Johnson over John Jones, personally. I still think John Jones is the best, you know, the GOAT, so to say. But that would be my reasoning for Demetrius Johnson. I mean, frankly, they're at the ends of the spectrum at this point. John Jones is like the best gigantic human being in the world. And yeah. Demetrius Johnson is like the best tiny person in the world. And there's no ifs, ands, or buts about it, I think, as far as I'm concerned. Whoever doesn't have Demetrius Johnson as their number one flyweight in the world, you're just fucking silly, frankly.
Yeah, John is like a foot taller than DJ.
Yeah, it might be more than a foot.
Yeah.
Is DJ 5'2"?
He's supposed to be 5'.
Now you got me.
He might be 5'4", or at least listed as 5'4".
Then it's about a foot.
DJ 5'3".
It's 5'3". Wow, 13 inches. Wow.
Yeah.
Dude, you're right. They are the opposite ends of the male human body spectrum.
Yeah, they are.
All right, Mark.
Imagine DJ was that fucking big. Like, if DJ was.
Oh, yeah, but that's also physics.
50 pounds.
It's also just physics. And, like, a guy who's Jones's frame and size cannot move his body that fast, as fast as that.
I mean, there is something to be said about that. But the footwork, though, right? There are technical aspects that are very different. There's the way that they strike. Like, John Jones's position and how he approaches a fight is very much about, like, taking guys down to the ground. Like, DJ will fucking strike and bang with you and get the best out of you, and he'll slip punches and he'll do a lot of things. But if he goes down to the ground, the man looks like an all-American wrestler on the ground, too. You know what I mean? He's so adept in every single position that it's difficult for me to not appreciate how significantly well-rounded he is. John Jones, to me, you know, we could argue that maybe earlier on in his career where guys were a little bit more one-dimensional earlier on, right? Like, a lot of these guys were coming out that had one real style that they worked with, right? Shogun was a Muay Thai guy. He wasn't going to really wrestle you that much. And so John might have been able to take advantages at those points, but I just think you could see John is a wrestler. John has adapted his style to work for how good his wrestling is, and his wrestling is some of the best wrestling that you will see in the UFC, maybe even better than Demetrius. But I think Demetrius is just an overall better fighter.
Okay.
I feel like you work John Jones into 50% of our episodes.
Really?
Do you feel like that, Mike? I feel like he always is like, if we make a comparison to, say, John Jones, like, all the fucking time. You love you some John Jones.
Jones is great, man. He's great.
No, I'm just giving you that was the comparison made sense in that spot. All right, so I haven't talked in a while. To remind, what I have given you so far is Dotson at 10, then Pantoja, then Horiguchi, then Pettis, and then Jussier Formiga. So to begin my top five, I will be the guy who has a little bit of a curveball. It is going to be Davison Figueiredo.
Whoa.
I understand
so curious.
You guys have him four. When I first started to jot my list down, I had him four. Obviously, he has been a champion in the UFC. The guy I have ahead of him has not. A huge plus in Figueiredo's corner is that he's only lost three times in his career, and it's been to two men. Obviously, Brandon Moreno finished him twice, and then his other losses to the man I have one spot behind him in Jussie Formiga. That aside, he's beaten everyone he's fought. But his resume is not terribly deep, if we're being honest. He beat Jared Brooks. He beat Pantoja, which, of course, is a good win. He beat Tim Elliott. He beat Joe Benavidez twice when he was much older and at the end of his career. And it wasn't even really twice, because the first one was due to a headbutt, which is why they rematched anyway. He beat Alex Perez. And then he's got the one Brandon Moreno win and the draw in a four-fight series. But he lost him twice. So, of course, it's nothing to scoff at all. You know, wins over Moreno and Pantoja and Benavidez are great on your resume. But to me, the resume, once I really broke it down, was not deep enough to put him over the man in my number four spot. And that man is, funny enough, the man who he's beaten twice, Joseph Benavidez.
Wow.
Holy shit.
I get it.
Wow.
If you want to say he got finished by Figueiredo twice, how can he be ahead of him? But let me reiterate. In the first fight, he lost because of a headbutt. So let's throw that out. From there, yes, he got beat by Figgy one time. But it's the second to last fight of his entire career. He takes one more fight. He retires. He was clearly not the same at that point. And taking a loss as an older fighter to Figgy, to me, was not enough to put him behind Figgy, because I just felt like the resumes were too incomparable. Like, okay. Benavidez's resume is so good that you could put him, like, two on this list, and I'd be like, yeah, like, I get it. Like, other than DJ, he's very easily the man in this top 10 with the longest list of quality wins. Like, he has beaten everyone. He started fighting in 2006, granted with a bunch of fights at bantamweight as well. He didn't lose to anyone other than Dominic Cruz or Demetrius Johnson until 2018. He had 25 other fights to that point that were not against Cruz or Johnson, and he won every single one of them. That's an insane run of success. And not to mention, one of his losses to each of those guys was a split, Cruz and DJ. So that other loss in 2018 finally did come. It was a really competitive split decision and toss-up against Sergio Pettis. He followed that up by knocking out Alex Perez, beating Dustin Ortiz, TKOing Jussie Formiga, who I had at six on my list. And then at the very end was the Figgy fights and the Askarov fight, and he walked away. But to me, he didn't look like he was at the top of his game anymore, and the list of wins is just enormous. I mean, he beat Formiga twice. He beat Cejudo. He beat McCall. He beat Yerushitani, who I mentioned earlier. He beat bantamweight great Miguel Torres, and many, many more of the guys who are like, that's a solid dude, that's a solid dude. So yes, he never became UFC champion, easily one of the best ever to not achieve that. But in the end, I couldn't deny the resume, and I just was more impressed by it than what Figueiredo's resume is at this point. So he snuck ahead of him as my number four fighter. Number three, Brandon Moreno. From here, I'm the same as you guys. You could argue him maybe against Henry if you wanted to. He obviously is still the current reigning defending UFC flyweight champion, so he could certainly add to this resume. Finishing Figueiredo twice, I feel like, puts a huge stamp on his resume. He's finished Kai Kara France twice as well. He's beaten him twice. Finished him once, though. He finished Brandon Royval. He beat Formiga. He did beat Askar Askarov, if it wasn't for some stupid judging in that draw. But I felt there was enough losses to keep him behind Cejudo. He lost to Pettis. He's got the two to Pantoja, if we're counting tough. The one to Figgy, obviously. Despite those, I'll point out he's another guy who's never been finished in his entire career. I mean, I guess he was on tough, but if we're talking pro career, he never has. And if he can turn back Pantoja in this next fight, his resume gets even stronger, so we'll see. But number two, I felt like did have to be Henry Cejudo. Handful of reasons why I feel like that's the correct spot. Obviously, you guys agree. I wasn't sure if you were going to. But one, he was the flyweight champion, moved up in weight to take the bantamweight belt as well and add double champ status to his resume. That's got to count for something. He beat Demetrius Johnson to take that flyweight title, which no man could do. And the main reason he's above Moreno for me is he was truly bested one time at flyweight. The Benavidez loss was super controversial. There was a point deduction involved. It was all over the place. And that loss aside, the only other loss is Aljo up at Bantamweight, which takes nothing away from his flyweight resume to me. So the DJ loss is really the only one, and he got it back. So you look at the names he's beaten, Formiga, Pettis, Mighty Mouse, Dillashaw, Cruz. That's more than Moreno can say, I think, at this point in his career. So I do think Henry deserves to be number two. And then number one, obviously, I knew we'd all agree here. If you make any top 10 flyweight list and you do not have DJ at number one, you can take your list and rip it up into tiny pieces and place it directly into a garbage can.
Correct.
He is the flyweight GOAT. No doubt about it. He reigned as UFC champ for 6 years, defended the title 12 times. Seven of those 12 defenses were finishes. He's given us highlights for days. The Ray Borg armbar is up there with my favorite highlights in the history of MMA.
Yep.
Throw in the Moraes highlight that he just gave us one fight ago with a knockout, and plenty more. When he did finally lose his title in the UFC, he still went to one, rattled off 5 out of 6. He gave us a great trilogy with Adriano Moraes, who was clearly much, much bigger than him, and he was still able to knock him out and then clearly win the third fight to take that trilogy. He's beaten 7 of the guys in my top 12. The only ones he hasn't are like the more modern fighters who he never had a chance to fight. And he just has a resume that I feel like will not be touched at flyweight for some time. I feel like the Henrys and the Morenos could even add to Henry's not going to fight at flyweight anymore, but Moreno, Figgy, whoever, I think they could add to theirs, and they're still not catching DJ at this point. So he's a clear one for me.
Yeah.
And that is it. Good work. Mike, we had the same exact 10 men.
Just in a different order.
Yep. Yep.
And Omar's was very similar, too. He just had McCall and Royval up in there.
I mean, I had McCall at 11, so not terribly
different. Dude, respect with the Royval pick, Mike. That's my guy. I just feel like guys like Royval and Kai Kara France, they're just too... The ink isn't dry.
Royval over Horiguchi set me.
The Pettis thing, though, I can't get behind the Pettis thing, man. I can't get behind the Pettis thing.
Pettis,
especially,
why?
especially if you're going to include his current success in a reasoning behind him being on a flyweight list, because the dude doesn't fight a flyweight anymore.
I only included Kyoji, since they're both flyweights.
I know, I'm not really on board for either one. But like, but Pettis winning a belt at 135 to me means dick all for a 125.
Call.
List, you know.
I mean, neither of us talked about that though.
Hansen,
touche,
huh?
Mike did.
I did.
You talked about him being bantamweight champ.
Well, he talked about him having a belt in at Bellator, which to me means nothing because that was at 135.
I mean, does it mean nothing to you that he beat Moreno and Benavidez and Formiga and Horiguchi?
Nothing.
Like that's a hell of a 4 men.
They are. And like I said, I think if I felt that those wins were that impactful in his current state of his career, I would probably have included him in 125. But I think what makes Sergio Pettis at this point the guy that people talk about is his bantamweight run. I think that's what has made Sergio Pettis Sergio Pettis.
Yeah, I mean, it never happened in the UFC in terms of a true breakthrough because he left.
Yeah, but his fight style was a little bit different. Like he was a lot more tentative back then. He was squeaking out decisions. You know what I mean? Like since he moved to bantamweight, he's fucking a lot of people up at bantamweight, dude. Like he looks good, a lot better in my opinion at bantamweight and in Bellator in general than he did in the UFC.
Yeah, I don't know. Agree to disagree.
Yeah, no, I get it. This list was a bitch, man. It really was. Tough.
I mean, and you did have Sergio in your honorables. It's not like we're so far off.
Because I started with him in there.
Because like no one is really that far apart from each other, but you can still argue it for days.
Even Kyoji as well. Like, you know,
we got
Kyoji was one of those guys at 125. He had his wins. He had his good performances. Fought for the belts and all that other stuff. But like, I feel like he's had so much success at 135 fighting in all these other. You know, the Bellators and the Ryzen and stuff like that, that it's hard for me to really stick him on a list for 125. You know what I mean? That's really where I ran into the issues, where the guys who bounced around quite a bit at 135 and 125 and where they really made the most impact of one over the other.
I get it. I get that. All right, Mike, who were your honorables again? Because I want to try to average this out like we did last time.
I just had one.
Time.
I just had Ian McCall at 11. Oh, and I had Marais.
You said a second one. Oh, yeah.
I said Marais and Ian
McCall. So you would say McCall 11, Marais 12?
Yeah.
That was my same. So we have the same top 12. That's wild.
God damn it.
And then, Omar, who were your honorables?
I guess if I'm putting them in order, I would put Pettis.
Yeah, try.
Pettis, Horiguchi, and Elliott.
Okay. And then, so, Mike, we would need to say where we would put Roy Val if we're going to make a group average, since Roy Val is on Omar's list. I guess I named 15 guys and he wasn't on it, but maybe he'd be 16 for me, I guess. I'm trying to think.
I have to think. I mean, as much as you guys know, I'm a Roy Val guy. I wouldn't consider him for an all-time flyweight yet.
He might be.
He just doesn't have any points to me.
Maybe 17 for me, if I have to put a number on it.
Say 16. I'll say 16.
Yeah.
I'll give him some love.
I'll say 7.
I mean, I fucking love the guy. I love him. I love the way he fights.
Yeah, I mean, with you guys having Horiguchi and, like, if I put Horiguchi and Sergio Pettis on my list, Ian McCall and Brandon Royval wouldn't have made it. But I just didn't, like I said from before, right. I just didn't find them eligible for my list.
Oh, dude, I don't hate it. I love seeing the differences. I mean, I put Benavidez over Figueiredo. I didn't expect to do that, and I know you guys didn't agree with it. All right, cool. I got to average
this out.
I don't
hate it though, man. Like Benavidez was, like I said, he was the prince, man. He was the Chad Mendez of that division for like the longest time.
Dude, the resume was just so long. I was like, oh my god, he beat fucking everyone.
Yeah, and it was a situation like a lot of times with a lot of these guys where if Demetrius Johnson wasn't the number one guy, Benavidez would have been a fucking champion long before that.
Well,
but
yeah,
Demetrius Johnson was, and valid. Benavidez just came in at the wrong time, I guess. You know what I mean? It just sucked. It was one of those things, like the Colby thing. You know, they talk about how if Usman hadn't been champion at the time, Colby would have been. And sometimes probably. That's just how the dice are rolled, you know?
Probably.
It's very true. Very true. All right.
Did we do it?
Well, that was good. I liked it. I like these top 10, man. They're fun. They're fun.
It's so fun.
We'll have to keep working our way.
So are we doing women next time? Or are we going back to women's list the next time we have an opportunity for this?
We did women's.
We did all women. Just all, we didn't.
Bro, I don't remember what
we've done. Oh, yeah, we did all women's because we felt like the individual weight classes were not quite as deep enough to bother.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we'll do bantamweight next time.
Bantamweight. Which is, I'm going to fucking murder myself doing bantamweight.
I was going to say, bantamweight is probably equally as ridiculous as flyweight, to be quite honest.
Oh, I think it's worse, dude. I think.
Because you got to go all the way back. You kind of have to go back to WEC a bit. You have to take that, I think, into consideration.
You have a large amount of modern dudes who you could argue should be on the list as well. Like, it's going to be a mess.
Yeah. Yeah. All right.
Yeah. Do we have any trivias, Mike?
We do not. There was no time for the trivia making.
All right.
If anybody out there wants to submit a fucking trivia question, that'd be awesome. That would be awesome. It would be.
Yeah, find a good way to do that without giving us the answer.
Give me the answer.
Yeah,
true. Well, how are they going to give it to you? You got to give them your email. Because if they send it to the group email, I think we're all going to get it.
DM me. Find me on
Instagram. Oh, yeah, DM them on Instagram.
The Michael Hansen on Instagram. Boom.
Yeah. Slide into his DMs. Give him a little something.
Slide into my DMs and be like, yo, listen to your show. I wanted to submit a trivia question. If you do it, I will shout you out. Be like, so-and-so submitted this trivia question. Thanks, so-and-so. Shout out.
Thanks, so-and-so.
Yeah. No dick pics, please. He is a taken man.
Okay.
All right, guys. I think we're good here. Let's get out of here.
Okay. Thanks for watching.
I'm still typing out here. You guys are out of control.
I'm averaging out all this shit to find our overall rankings. I'm almost done right now. I'm almost
doing
done.
The same thing. Omar's like,
oh, you're doing it so too?
So goodbye.
People in their cars what are they doing right now?
I gotta go prep my shit for tomorrow for my kids lunch and all that shit.
Oh boy, that's tough.
Tell him to put bologna on his own goddamn
bread.
Yeah,
man. Oh, fuck. I forgot to say at the beginning of the show. Cool news. John Jones is going to be a special guest of Anthony Pettis Fighting Championship in Milwaukee.
Yeah, he fucking is.
And I'm going to get to announce the man himself at the beginning of the night. I can't believe I'm going to say words into a microphone that is introducing John Jones into a crowd.
Yeah, that's pretty sick.
I can't believe it.
And Bilal Muhammad, too, is going to be there, too, but that's sick.
And Bilal.
Literally the coolest thing I've ever heard in my life.
Dude, Nico Price was at the regional fight that I was at this weekend where
you saw him?
Yeah. He was I'm assuming there must have been his camp or guys from his camp must have been fighting obviously at a much lower level, but I saw him. I saw somebody else and I've been trying to remember for the last 2 days who the fuck it was, but like I have no idea anymore. But it was cool to see UFC guys very normal just chilling at these events and helping their fighters out and things like that. I think is dope.
That's awesome. All right, folks.
The averages. Should I say it before the show?
Okay, say it real quick.
So as a whole, our rankings were: DJ 1, Cejudo 2, Moreno 3, Figueiredo 4, Benavidez 5, Pantoja 6 on the back of Omar's high ranking. Formiga 7.
Wow.
Pettis 8. Horiguchi 9. Dotson 10.
Wow.
That was our collective ranks.
I love it.
And then McCall would have been the odd man out, followed by
I think that's a pretty good Roy list. Val. I'm not mad at that list at all.